First of all, I would like to thank you very much for the invitation. I'd like to thank Cogen for inviting me today at your annual conference to deliver a speech. It is a pleasure and an honor for me to be here with you, and I would like to thank you and all participants that joined remotely today. There is indeed an important discussion at the EU level related to our pathway, to our ambitious goals, of course, total decarbonization in 2050, and Fit for 55 as intermediary strategic target for 2030. There is indeed a power of heat. Heat as a form of energy, or heat repurposed from the waste of energy consumption, will help us deliver on our climate ambitions and reach our goals for 2030 and 2050. The Fit for 55 package, which now will be in a debate in European Parliament and also in the Council between the member states, should pave the road to reach this. The Commission came with a very ambitious proposal. I'm talking about the first part of Fit for 55 package. But in some areas, I believe that the reality is still different and still not ready for this transformation. Consequently, we policymakers, we need to maintain this ambition. We need to be bold. We need to give a clear horizon, a clear pathway to our industry, to our member states. Important investment will be needed. So we need also a stable framework, and we need stability, but in the same time, we need to find the proper balance in this debate. We need to introduce in the discussion the principle of technological neutrality that will grant our citizens and our businesses access to the best technology at the most affordable price, allowing our economy to be a world leader in the climate transition. The way to reach the target is hard and challenging, but our job is to maintain also an open dialogue with all the stakeholders involved in order to mitigate risks and capitalizing the opportunities towards climate innovation in the transition. We must understand that in the end, in our fight for ideologies and dogmas, we need to pay attention to the low-income families, to the middle-class homeowners and car owners. We need to look closely to the people in rural areas without public transport. We'll have to pay attention on ones living in coal-dependent regions, because we should not jeopardize the competitivity of our industries. We should not jeopardize the jobs that we already have. We should keep affordable prices for our citizens and for our industries. We need to ensure consistency across policies. We need to streamline our climate ambitions, but with a feasible transition, leaving no region behind, with no industrial sector being barred, ensuring further resilience, both in the energy and industrial sector. And of course, we should be extremely attentive to the security of our energy supply, which is extremely relevant also in today's context with the rise of prices in energy. I will finish by saying also a few words about the main topic of our discussions, the importance of heat and heating. And one important question could be, what role will Fit for 55 have in supporting high efficiency cogeneration and district heating? These are key solutions to reduce the consumption of fossil fuels and maximizing the use of clean and renewable energy sources. The heating sector currently represents 50% of the final energy consumption. The EU building stock is the largest single energy consumer in Europe, and of course is one of the main emitters of EU GHG emissions. Moreover, 50% of global energy consumption is wasted in the form of heat. Industries such as steel, aluminium, and shipping are primary contributors. Heating and cooling accounts the EU's biggest energy use, and is expected to remain so. generation will recover heat for use in homes, businesses, and industry, cogeneration. Significantly, through cogeneration, we can achieve energy efficiency levels. Small cogeneration facilities can also be an effective way to supply energy to remote areas without the need for expensive grid infrastructure. I also believe that in the context of a current very low energy renovation rates across the EU, which are clearly insufficient, we really need to ensure necessary energy savings, and we need to at least double in the coming years in order to achieve our goals by 2050. Given its weight in the overall energy mix and at the same time the potential for decarbonization, the heating sector should be a top priority for the policymakers, should be the sector where energy efficiency efforts are deployed first. It means renovation of the existing building stocks, the construction of new facilities following the principles of near zero energy building, but also reducing primary energy consumption on the supply side via cogeneration or tree generation. The lesson today should be also about the importance of a diverse and increasingly renewable energy mix across electricity, heat and gas networks to ensure a resilient energy system at the lowest cost for consumers. Furthermore, the initiative on the renovation wave will seek to establish an action plan with concrete measures to address the main barriers and reinforce the pull factors. The heating and cooling sector need to deliver deep decarbonization, and there is a strong potential for the heat systems, for instance, to integrate the use of heat from power plants via cogeneration, industry, waste incineration, solar, thermal or geothermal, large-scale heat pumps. In many member states, the potential for renovation and large-scale energy projects remains largely unexploited, and we need investment in this area because otherwise it is difficult to reach our targets. We need to design the future proposal as to encourage consolidated public and private investments for the green transformation. It's not enough to use the grants from the Resilience Facility, from the Modernization Fund, from other European Union funds, cohesion funds even, but we need also to trigger, to incentivize the private industry, the banks, the hedge funds, the investors to co-invest in order to contribute to the green transformation. And of course, for this, we need to set the right framework for energy systems integration, the right framework for the renovation wave, the right framework for cogeneration, the right framework to use much more renewables in the near future. And here, of course, the revision of RED II directive and the energy efficiency directive, the two main legislative acts that ITRE committee, the committee that I'm chairing, is responsible, are extremely important. Finally, last word is to remind everyone that we need to go in this direction. We need to convince other global players to follow our example, but we need not to forget that the transformation should be balanced, should be feasible for all our regions, for all the member states, for all industrial sectors, and of course, should bring in the end great benefits to the citizens, because they really are the most important. Thank you so much.